coming revolution in science and knowledge. My aim today is to make this coming revolution plausible to you, introduce you to absolute science, which will replace and absorb existing science, and inspire you to become involved in this in this incredible thing that is coming on the scene and into history. So first, some background and context as to what has happened. Second, a brief intro to absolute science and logic. And third, a concrete example of what true knowledge is. Okay, first, the background. History is now over. The history of philosophy on planet Earth is nothing but the universe becoming conscious of itself. Hence, the Greeks were right. The universe is intelligible. It can be understood. Most importantly, there is only one philosophy or science, which in fact is God's science of himself, personally, which the university is destined to become. It was Plato and Aristotle, the teachers, who set the agenda by insisting that humanity, quote, has to exit the cave of multiplicity and separation and enter the reality of unity, or God's self-thinking thought, achieved in the modern period, first with Descartes, shift from objects outside us to our subject and consciousness. And finally, with Kant, Fichte, Schelling, and Hegel's transformation of philosophy into absolute science, Wissenschaft, the unity of all the sciences. What also has happened is an incredible event in Hegel's studies. For 200 years, our best minds have struggled to understand Hegel's logic. Hegel's logic, the master key to science, with varying success. There is a growing consensus that Richard Winfield has finally cracked the code in his recent book, Hegel's Science of Logic, A Critical Rethinking in 30 Lectures. With the floodgates of absolute science now opened, I am here today to proclaim and predict that within 5 to 15 years, absolute science will be taught in all schools and universities of the world, and as a result, God's kingdom on earth, the total healing of the world, will finally become a reality. So, tremendous kudos to Richard Winfield. Now, there are many things that most do not know about Hegel and the logic, including Hegelians. I quote from Hegel. With absolute knowledge and absolute science, history has come to an end. Everyone must now make a clean sweep in their discipline. Religion is intuitive philosophy, which is simply cognizant religion. Both use different methods to seek the same thing, God. Only the arrogance of immaturity and the selfishness of privileged obscurantism can possibly stop the dawning day. Okay. And, quote, the science of logic is the truth without veil, and presents God as he is in his eternal essence prior to the creation of the universe. Hegelians are even unaware that the final category of Hegel's logic is kingdom come, here and now, the unity of the knowing subject and the objective world, as we'll see shortly. Many are also unaware that Hegel holds that we are immortal. Quote, spirit, the individual soul, is immortal and eternal. Now, as many of us do know, our current sciences are in crisis. Thank you, Husserl. They lack unity and are stuck in specialization and disconnection from each other. Above all, they are not true knowledge. This is simply because to truly know anything, you have to know everything, the whole, period. Is this possible, though? How can you know everything? Hegel's brilliant and astounding answer is you can, because you are everything. You contain all reality within yourself. Cf. The kingdom of God is within you. So to know yourself is to know everything. Again, quote, the self, reason or consciousness is all reality, as quantum physics has also realized. Here again, through the study of logic, Hegel, the mind develops an unsuspected power of assimilating in rational form all the sciences in their complex variety. Logic, reason, is the power which leads into all truth. Hence, we can know all, everything. Okay, second, an intro to absolute science. Now, Hegel's term for this self is the begriff, the concept. Therefore, to do or engage in absolute science, to know everything, the whole, das Ganze, you must first have the concept and know that the concept, the self, is all reality. You must first have overcome the number one illusion of the separation of the concept, yourself, and reality. Subject and object, self and other, which results in many cases in mental addictions. Hence, the phenomenology, the introduction to absolute science, which friends are updating right now. So, with the concept in hand, you are now in a position to know everything in its essence. As Hegel says, the concept is alles, everything. It contains within itself the infinite realm of all that is objective. Hence, the concept is the being, the inner structure of everything in the universe. Thus, to know anything truly, we just look for the determinations of the concept in nature and spirit as a whole and in the given object of investigation. The concept is the truth, it's God. And the truth is a process, a living movement that we are all involved in. The becoming of the truth, the kingdom of God. For the absolute, quote, is a result. The three-step process is essentially this. The introductions or phenomenology's result, the truth, is that the concept or thought is reality. This is the logic. Concept, the inner, the unextended, which demands its opposite or negation, nature, the outer, infinite extension, matter, which finally demands the unity of these opposites, the negation of negation, namely spirit, the truth actualized, the unity of inner and outer, matter and consciousness. Absolute science is nothing but the study of this process and has three parts, the sciences of logic, nature, and spirit. It is one science, as it is only one entity's knowledge of itself, being, the idea, the universe, God, or the absolute, and hence it contains all sciences within itself. To the question, what are the determinations of the concept, the key to true knowledge? The answer is universality, allgemeinheit, particularity, and individuality, UPI for sure, which is revealed in the logic, the foundation, the archetype of all the sciences. Here is the system of absolute science and how to do it in 2 minutes. After you've achieved the concept via the introduction, you unfold its determinations in the science of logic, epitomized in UPI. Then you organize and translate the contents of the real sciences of nature and spirit, e.g. physics, botany, anthropology, sociology, into the concept. As Hegel says, the absolute scientist simply, quote, makes the contents of the real or empirical sciences imitate the free creative thought of the concept. And note, we do not impose the concept on the content or thing from the outside, as the thing already contains the concept's moments within itself. We just discern them. More concretely, first, logic. Again, I am indebted to Winfield for much of what follows. What is logic? Good question. Logic is the concept or idea as pure thought enclosed in itself or unexpressed. It is the logos through which all that is was created. And Aristotle's highest thought, noesis, noesios, self-thinking thought, God's essence, fully revealed and explicated. As therapy, logic accomplishes the healing of the divided, schizophrenic Western mind. 5 points. 1, thought is in motion. It's living, fluid, alive. The first thought category of logic is being. All thought categories are contained in being, or God, and developed via the principle of all life, absolute negativity, the negation of negation, the unity of opposites. Thus, being becomes quality, quantity, measure, essence, ground, appearance. Finally, unbeknownst to many, being becomes God, or kingdom come, olam haba, in the doctrine of the concept, comprised of the subject, the object or world, and finally, the idea, the unity of subject and object. First, as the immediate idea, life, then as its negation, man, or knowledge, man's theoretical and practical separation from the world, object, trying to get together, doing the true and the good, then as the concept, the negation or overcoming of the separation, God, the absolute idea, kingdom come, the concept realized. But in thought, hence we now move from thought to thought's opposite, nature. And since thought is reality, nature, matter, as its opposite is nothing. And since thought, and then finally to spirit, the unity of logic and nature, and to kingdom come actualized, which ironically the church and religion are unaware exists right now. This despite Jesus' teaching that the kingdom of God, quote, comes not by observation, i.e. by the senses and the present arrangements of material reality, but rather, quote, the kingdom of God is within you. It's an affair of consciousness, idea. Hence, it is now. And this is the case, of course, because phenomenal time is an illusion. Allah, among others, Einstein, The distinction between past, present, and future is only an illusion. Schrodinger, the present, is the only thing that has no end. And Hegel, eternity, will not be, nor has it been. It is. And two, Hegel tells us that repulsion and attraction are not forces externally applied to matter. The view of today's physicists, they are matter itself. Kudos to Kant. Matter is the perfect unity of opposites, of the opposites, attraction and repulsion. If there were only repulsion, matter would disperse to infinity. If there were only attraction, matter would vanish into a point. Only as their unity does the material universe exist. Three, contradiction, passe today's Verstand logicians, is not unthinkable. Everything, says Hegel, has contradiction within it. Matter, life, emotions, desire. Take motion. The earth, as it moves around the sun, both is and is not in a given place at a given time. Contradiction. Four, Hegel's concept of appearance, the sense world, is unique and the opposite of that of Plato, Kant, the Buddhists, and the Hindus. For Hegel, the essence appears. It totally reveals itself and is not hidden in another world behind what appears. What you see is the essence. Essence and appearance are one. Five, as for the infinite or infinity, contrary to what today's scientists believe, it can indeed be comprehended. It's not the indefinite, never-ending n plus one of the mathematicians, but is to be grasped only by the negation of the distinction between self and other, you and me, or finitude. Simply, to the other, it is I who am the other. We are one. This is the infinite which can be comprehended. In Shakespeare's Juliet's immortal words to Romeo, my bounty is as boundless as the sea, my love as deep. The more I give to thee, the more I have, for both are infinite. Second, nature. What is nature? Nature is the concept, the idea, the truth, God, outside of itself, emptied into infinite space and time. Indeed, matter and all of nature, from diatoms to whales, the planets, the galaxies, is simply externalized thought or intelligence. Nature's science, the knowledge of nature, is accordingly divided into universality or mechanics, space, time, matter, motion, i.e. universal matter, nature's foundation, particularity or physics, i.e. particularized or qualified matter, the moment of difference, and individuality or organics, that is individuated matter, the return to universality, but as concrete unity, life, the subject. I'm indebted to Cinzia Farini and Thomas Posch for their stellar research. And I will be teaching a course on Hegel Science of Nature here in the fall. Two points. Hegel's position is that nature or matter is nothing. It's ideal. Quote, nature has vanished, Hegel tells us, on the completion of its process. So, how does nature vanish or set itself aside? Simply by moving from two to one. Briefly, we start with space, first category of nature, with every point outside every other point, infinite. No two points coinciding. Then space becomes matter, the unity of space and time. Where points touch, we have contiguity. See, matter, contiguity, points touch. Then matter yields to gravity, the first subject or unity. Where all bodies, objects on Earth, e.g., seek the same center, point. Then to a closer unity in physics, in the meteorological process, magnetism, electricity, and chemism, then finally to life and the animal organism, where we see the unity of concept and reality, body and soul. The outcome is that the same soul in this point, finger, is the same soul in this point, or finger, no matter how far apart these are. All points, therefore, coincide in one point. The outer externality, parts outside parts, is overcome. The truth is, matter has no truth. Two, because the organic life and the inorganic are dialectically interdependent, you can't have one without the other, there must be life in the universe. As today's anthropic principle and Gaia hypothesis both contend. And the human body, or form, is the perfect type from which all the other organisms are to be comprehended, not vice versa. Third, spirit, Geist, or intelligence. Okay, what is spirit? Spirit is the idea returning back to itself from its otherness in nature. Spirit is the negation of negation, the unity of opposites, thought and nature. Just 2 points. So, one, nature sets itself aside and becomes spirit, the truth of nature. Here again, with logic's concept as our guide, we begin with universality in the subjective spirit, with the natural feeling soul in anthropology, prior to division into self and world, the world is inside itself. Then to particularity or division as consciousness of a world in phenomenology. And then to individuality in psychology as spirit or intelligence, the unity of self and world, as theoretical functions, perception, imagination, memory, and practical functions, the drives, choice, happiness, and the absolutely free will. Then on to objective spirit, and the actualization of the free will in right, morality, and the ethical life of the family, civil society, and the state. And two, finally, to absolute spirit, the unity of subjective and objective spirit, which treats the absolute truth in art as beauty, in religion as the good, and in absolute science as truth in its highest form. The concept, Aristotle's divine thought of thought, which is logic and the return to the beginning. But with this difference, logic, or the concept, is now completely certified by the concrete content of nature, history, and spirit. A unification of all three. In religious language, of God and creation. Reich Gottes. Kingdom come fully actual. The transfiguration of humanity into an immortal race of Elohim, gods and goddesses, world without end. And this closes the circle of absolute science. which nonetheless is open to indefinite expansion pending further empirical investigation. I'm glad you guys got here. We had to go early, somebody didn't show up. So. But I appreciate your attendance. I will conclude with an example of what true knowledge actually is, or how to know something, life, by means of the concept. Keep in mind, since to truly know anything, you have to know everything, life, a subset of nature, must be understood in the context of the whole. And since nature as a whole gets transcended into spirit, life too, as something independent, gets sublated as well, reduced to a moment of the whole. This chart depicts the total context in which life, the animal organism, is to be understood. The concept is the veritable DNA of all the forms of nature and spirit. First, we have the highest division of the whole, the absolute, the idea, the universe, God. What's that? Into logic, universal, nature, the particular, creation, and spirit. Man actualized, God realized. Note, in every case, the third is the unity and truth of the first two, the individual of the universal and particular. We then have, e.g., the division of nature into mechanics, physics, and organics. Finally, the division of organics into the geological organism, the plant nature, and the animal organism, and the division of the animal organism into shape, U, assimilation, P, genus process, or sex relation. Beautiful. Each moment of the concept, UPI, makes itself into a complete syllogism, Schluss in German, fantastic word, close. Bring the opposites into a unity. That's what's going on since the beginning of time, so we have to find the unity in German. And is the totality, or contains the others in itself. The syllogism, the close, is the unity of opposites. In the case of shape, the animal organism relates to itself, or closes with itself, through regeneration, consuming itself. The concept as soul, sila, closes or unites with its object, its body. In assimilation, the organism relates to an other, external inorganic nature, or closes with an other, such as nutriment, which it converts into itself, into animality. In the genus process, in which is the unity of the first two, of self-relation and relation to other, the organism closes with itself through copulation or union with an other that is itself, its own kind. The result, which is also the result of nature as a whole, is both one, a new individual, the same as itself, and the preservation of the species, and two, the death or negation of the individual, which is at once the realization of the genus, the universal, as thought, and the transition to spirit or mind, the last and highest sphere of realities or God's self-actualization. We'll briefly consider shape, whose moments are the functions of the organism, the systems of shape, and the total structure. The organism's functions are sensibility, the universal, where the one universal soul is everywhere present and feels in all parts of its body. Irritability, particularity, in particular, which is receptivity to external stimulation and reaction to it. And reproduction, the individual, whereby the organism constantly renews itself as an individual. These three functions have their reality in three systems and anatomical centers, which centers are the same in all animals from insect to man: head, thorax, abdomen. Sensibility has its reality in the nervous system and its center in the head, the brain. Irritability, its reality in the circulatory system, and its center is the thorax, the heart. Reproduction has its reality in the digestive system, and its center in the abdomen, the intestines. The total structure is the unity of the two, the process whereby the organism preserves itself by consuming itself. Each member, organ, consumes all the others, hence his end, and is in turn consumed by them, is also means. In this way, the life of the whole organism is maintained. In Hegel's words, or jargon, the immediate idea is life, concept, is realized as soul in a body. The soul is the immediate self-relating universality of the body's externality. It is equally the particularizing of the body, so that the body expresses no distinctions in itself other than the determinations of the concept. And finally, it is individuality as infinite negativity, the dialectic of the body's scattered objectivity, which is led back into subjectivity from the semblance of independent existence. This alone, I submit, is the true knowledge of life, to be contrasted with a typical biology textbook's account of life, a hodgepodge of disconnected facts and isolated observations with no principle of unity and no clear, coherent concept of what life is. A bricolage which can in no way count as knowledge, only doxa. In science, we are solely concerned with the truth. The truth is in logic, the concept or reason. Our scientific concern with nature and spirit, humanity, can thus only be to discern the ways and extent to which nature and spirit embody the truth. If I had more time, I'd show you how the solar system, the sun universal, the earth individual, and the moon and comets particular, and the state, e.g. the legislative, judicial, and executive powers, UPI, both as embodiments of reason, can be accurately comprehended by the concept. To sum up, history is over. The healing of the world has begun. Absolute science is coming into history and the world and all educational institutions. All of this thanks to R.D. Winfield and others. And I know that what I've given you is only a glimmer of absolute science, but I hope it is enough to inspire you to join us and the revolution. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor.